Are you ready for the grand finale of our server security series? Today, we're unlocking the final steps with DNS records and port forwarding to bring your home server fully online and accessible from anywhere in the world. Hey everyone, welcome back to Tenevin Tech and our server security series. In the last video, we set up Athelia to provide user accounts and authentication for our Docker stack. If you missed that one, hit the card above or click the link in the description to catch up. I've created a GitHub repository with all the files used in this tutorial. Feel free to copy them and use them for your own projects. The link is in the description below. Today, we're wrapping up this tutorial series by completing the last steps and bringing our server online. We'll cover what DNS records are and how they work, what port forwarding is, how to add DNS records to our domain, how to set up port forwarding in our router, starting up our traffic service and verifying traffic's automatic SSL certificate generation works, and accessing our server from the internet for the first time. By the end, we'll be able to securely access our server from anywhere. What are DNS records? DNS records are instructions that live in authoritative DNS servers and provide information about a domain, including what IP address is associated with that domain and how to handle requests for that domain. When a request comes into our domain, the DNS servers will find a record that matches and redirect the request to the correct destination. And it can do this without revealing the destination IP address, so we can keep our server's real location hidden. What is port forwarding? Port forwarding is a network configuration that tells a router to send incoming internet traffic destined for a specific port on its public IP address to a particular device and port on its private local network, making services like remote access, gaming, and home servers accessible from the outside world. Now let's explore how we can add DNS records to our domain. Every domain registrar is different, so in the interest of making this applicable to everyone, I'll just explain the DNS records themselves. The process of adding them may look different depending on the domain registrar, but the records you will need to add will be the same. First, we'll need to find out what our public static IP address is. We can do this by running a curl request. You may need to install curl if your system doesn't have it installed by default. Now that we've got our public static IP address, let's see how the DNS records will look like depending on the domain name we've chosen. Let's assume that you've chosen a root domain like server.com. The DNS records for this domain would look like this. We need two A records that point to our public IP address. One will have the at symbol, and the other will have an asterisk. The at symbol record is targeting the root domain itself, so server.com itself will be redirected to our IP address. The asterisk is a wildcard, which means any subdomain under server.com will also be redirected to our IP address. If your domain registrar doesn't support wildcard records, then you may need to specify each subdomain instead, like this. The TTL, or time to live, will default to auto or 1 hour most of the time, which is just fine for our use case. The pattern is similar if we were to choose a subdomain like home.server.com. This time, the at symbol is replaced with the subdomain name home, and the wildcard is an asterisk with a .home following it. And this is what they should look like if your registrar doesn't support wildcards. And the pattern would continue if you choose to do a subdomain of a subdomain, and so on. But for this example, we are using home.server.com. Once you've added the records, it can take some time for the changes to propagate worldwide. You can use whatsmydns.net to check its status. While they say it can take up to 24 hours, I found that most of the time is done updating in around 1 to 5 minutes. Now let's look at how to set up port forwarding in our router. Just like with the DNS records, setting up port forwarding will look different depending on your router, but the rules will look similar for everyone. We will need to get the static IP address of our server, which we can find in our environment file if you've been following this series. But if you don't have this, then you can use this command to find what your server's IP address is. When you find your router's port forwarding settings, you will need to add two rules, one for HTTP and one for HTTPS. Both should point to your server IP address and use the TCP protocol. After saving, wait a few minutes for the changes to take effect. Even though we may have the DNS record set and the port forwarding configured, they will both only point to our server, which has firewall rules to only allow requests to go to our traffic service by its static IP address. This means if our traffic service is down, no one will be able to access anything on our server thanks to the firewall, keeping us secure even when traffic goes offline. If you missed the video where we set up uncomplicated firewall for our server, click the card above or check the link in the description below. But let's go ahead and start it up for the first time. Let's make sure we've modified traffic static configuration to use the Let's Encrypt staging server so we can test that our SSL certificates are being generated correctly. Once you've started traffic, monitor the traffic.log file for errors relating to our domain. This could take a few minutes, so give it some time if you need to. If you see errors, check to ensure your DNS records and port forwarding are properly set up. When I was going through this process prior to making this video, I ran into an error where the acme.json file had the incorrect permissions, so traffic was ignoring the certificate resolver. Once I changed the permissions to the JSON file, everything worked as expected. And now that we've configured that the certificate generation works, let's go back into our traffic static configuration and switch it back to the production Let's Encrypt servers so we can get real SSL certificates. And we'll need to restart traffic once we've changed its static configuration. Give it a couple minutes, and then verify that our acme.json file has certificates saved to it. It should look something like this, and there should be a certificate for each service traffic is hosting. Now we are ready to access our server for the first time. Depending on where you are, you may have access to fewer services due to the IP whitelist, if you configured one in your traffic middlewares. If you followed the series and added your local network to the IP whitelist, then you will need to be using a device on your local network to access your services. Go to your browser and navigate to your domain. This is the URL we set to be our homepage, but we should be redirected to Authelia to log in. When you get to Authelia for the first time, it'll have you log in and set a two-factor authentication method. Then it'll promptly forget that it was supposed to redirect you to homepage. So we'll type in the domain name again. Ta-da! From here, we can navigate to our other services to verify that they work and are secured with our SSL certificates. And to do a little cleanup, we'll also uninstall OpenSSL. If you've been watching this entire series and made it this far, you should now be able to add more applications to your server knowing exactly how to properly access and protect them. If you want to automate the setup of your Docker Compose stack, give Citadel a try. Citadel is a guided terminal UI that walks you through configuring a bulletproof security stack in minutes. With Citadel, you can automate the installation of UFW, Docker, Docker Socket Proxy, Authelia, CrowdSec, Traffic, and more, all with a simple terminal interface. It's perfect for anyone who wants enterprise-level security without weeks of manual configuration. Click the link in the description to get started. This has been an incredible journey through server security, and I want to hear from you. What should I tackle next? Whether it's adding more applications and local AI to our Docker Compose stack, looking into server backup utilities, or entirely different topics, let me know in the comments below. I've got a few ideas brewing, but I'd love to know what is resonating most with you. If you found this video helpful, give it a thumbs up and subscribe for more. And if you haven't seen our Authelia video yet, click here or check the link in the description. Thank you all for joining me in this server security series. Thanks for watching, and enjoy your secure servers.